you're frantically shooting in the field, it can be easy to overlook certain details like shutter speed, ISO, white balance, perfect framing, the list goes on. But that doesn't have to be a complete deal breaker for your footage. So today I want to share 8 super simple editing techniques that you can use to fix up some of those things that you might have overlooked in camera. And for that one person in the comments right now, yes, of course, you should always get the footage as correct as possible while you're shooting it. That's not the point of this video. When we shot the intro that you just saw, we were standing in a river in the rain. Main priority was to not get washed away and not destroy our cameras. The 180 degree roll may have come second at times. That being said, let's jump on in and first talk about fixing the white point of your footage, how bright the brightest pixels in the shot are. On most cameras, if you're shooting in a log color profile and you're not at your camera's native ISO, then the dynamic range is limited. And the result of that is that your white point and your highlights will be kind of squished down to where they're not quite all the way to 100% white. So you can see that on the scopes in Premiere, you'll see that your highlights are kind of squished down to this big lump that's below the actual white point. The easy fix for this is just to use the Lumetri color panel and adjust the whites of your footage until you see those brightest pixels hit 100 on the scopes. This isn't gonna bring back any detail in the highlights, but it will prevent you from having that weird kind of gray, not quite white highlights look. Next up, let's move on from white point to white balance. And this is another thing that's ridiculously easy to just overlook on location and can completely throw off your color grade. But luckily, there are a few easy ways to correct it in post. So the first and probably fastest way most of the time is to just use the eyedropper in the Lumetri color panel. Just use that eyedropper to select something in the frame that should be white, like a white t-shirt or a white wall, and Premiere will adjust the temperature and tint of the shot so that that area of the frame is white. If you have skin tones in the shot, you can also mask those out to isolate them, then look at the vector scope in the Lumetri scopes and adjust the temperature and tint so that that skin tone is accurate. And if you don't have a white object or skin tones in your shot, it's perfectly fine to just adjust the white balance manually. Just look at the shot and adjust the temperature and tint until it looks more accurate. Next up, let's talk a bit about stabilizing your footage and how useful it can be, but also when you should avoid it, because it can definitely ruin the clip if it's used the wrong way. If your shot has very noticeable handheld camera motion in it or just a lot of motion in the frame, then I would stay away from trying to stabilize it in post. I mean, you can give it a shot, but you're probably not gonna be too pleased with the results. And honestly, most of the time, it just makes the motion even more noticeable in the final result. But if you have a shot that's already pretty stable in its camera motion and just doesn't have a ton of motion throughout the frame in general, then you can use some post stabilization to get rid of those tiny little distracting jitters. It makes a huge difference. Since I'm working in Premiere, I use Warp Stabilizer for this, but most other software like Final Cut and DaVinci has some kind of stabilization tool built into it. And I almost always reduce like the smoothness or the intensity of the effect to like somewhere between 5% and 10%, sometimes even less, just so it's not noticeable and so it's not distracting from the camera motion and making it look wobbly and weird. All right, next up, let's talk about correcting the horizon line of your footage. This is a tiny little detail, still worth correcting. The horizon line is, of course, the line that the horizon falls on. It's basically just a way to make sure that your shot is like level rather than being tilted a little to the right or a little to the left. And especially if you're shooting on a tripod, no matter how hard you try to mess around with the feet and get it perfectly level, it's not always gonna be spot on. So you might have to do a tiny little tweak in post to make sure it's perfect. But it's a really easy fix by just adjusting the rotation until the shot is perfectly level and then increasing the scale to hide the edges, because when you rotate the clip like that, you're gonna see the edges of the frame and the shot. One little kind of bonus tip to make this easier on yourself is to hold down Command or Control when you're adjusting those sliders for like the position or the rotation, and that will make them move more slowly so you can make a more fine-tuned adjustment. Next up, kind of the graduated version of adjusting your horizon line is just full-on reframing the shot, maybe punching in or even just adjusting the position to change the way the shot was framed and just make it a slightly different composition. This is really easy to do when you're editing in a cropped sequence. So for example, I shoot the vast majority of my footage in a 16:9 aspect ratio, but I almost always edit in either an 18:9 or 2.35:1 aspect ratio. So I have this empty space on the top and bottom of the frame where I have extra clip that's not gonna make it into the final sequence. So I can easily just adjust my position on the clip to frame it a little higher or a little lower. This can also be an option when you're shooting in a higher resolution. So for example, we shot the intro to this video in 6K, so there's plenty of extra resolution to punch in to like 120, 130, 140% scale and adjust the position to completely reframe the shot. You definitely need to be careful if you're doing that, because even if you have that extra resolution to work with, zooming into the shot that much is going to make you lose some sharpness and detail and make the shot look a little muddier, but it is an option if you really have to do that. Next up, the technique that has had probably the biggest impact on my work in particular is removing noise from your footage. To do this, I use a plugin called Neat Video. I know you can do the same thing in After Effects, I believe. I think like DaVinci, probably Final Cut, have options to do the same thing, but Neat Video is hands down the way to go. It's an external plugin. You can get it for like Premiere, Final Cut, whatever software you're using. I think it's about $80 and it's a steal. Using this plugin to remove noise and grain has saved so much of my footage, particularly footage that I shot around dusk or nighttime that would have just been completely unusable without being able to remove that noise. It's an absolute lifesaver. And while we're on the topic of plugins, let's talk a bit about adding motion blur in post. Shutter angle is another one of those things that's just easy to overlook when you're out shooting. I mean, sometimes you don't have that extra 20, 30 seconds to switch out the ND filter and get that perfect exposure. Sometimes you have to cut your losses and just crank up the shutter. And the result of that is footage that looks a little off because of that lack of motion blur, especially if you have a lot of motion in the shot that should have that blur on it. Typically, I add motion blur in post using RSMB, or Real Smart Motion Blur. It's a plugin for Premiere, Final Cut, DaVinci, pretty much any software you're using that allows you to really easily just add a realistic amount of motion blur back into the clip. But if you don't want to buy a completely separate plugin just for motion blur, which is very understandable, you can achieve a very similar effect by using After Effects and applying an effect called CC Force Motion Blur. And finally, let's end off with a tip that's not really a tip, but more kind of a general overarching mindset to go into this with. And that's just to embrace the flaws of your footage. If your footage has really bright, blown out highlights, don't try to grade really dark and miraculously bring them back. If your footage is very shaky, has a lot of handheld camera motion, don't try to stabilize it when it's not gonna work. Maybe instead try cutting that footage in a way that's very high energy and embraces that shaky handheld feel. Just don't try to fit a square peg into a round hole, because great editing is not always about taking footage and like hammering it into what you want it to be. More often than not, it's about working with what you have and making the best thing you can in the context of the footage you have, even if that footage you have places some limitations on what you can do with it. Before we close out this video, I want to briefly tell you about my channel membership, because if you're still watching through to this point in the video, that's something you just might be interested in. On this channel, I have a membership option where you can pay either $10 or $15 a month and get access to raw footage from my videos as well as raw photos that I post on Instagram. You get extended tutorials that are like 40, 50, 60 minutes long. And there's also a members only Discord server where you can ask me any questions you may have about film or photography or anything. And you can send me your work and I'll give you some feedback on it. So recently I made a members only tutorial about how I make my motion graphics for these videos. So you saw a lot of cool little like graphics and animations throughout this video. I made an hour long video diving into in detail how I put all of those together. And then sometime within the next week or two, I'll be releasing the raw footage from the intro to this video so you can download it and edit it for yourself. It's been really cool to grow a little community over there and provide some value to your process in a more in-depth kind of hands-on way. So if that sounds like something that you'd be interested in, that you would benefit from, there will be a link in the description, or you can just click the join button on my channel homepage. I hope you enjoyed it, learned something new from it. If you did, feel free to show your support by leaving a like on the video, sharing it with your friends, or even subscribing to my channel and following me on Instagram. Keep creating, and I'll see you in the next one.